when you see a student who didn't understand it start to understand it.
Yeah. Even in like OT, those moments in peds and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, I think as a pediatric therapist or as an OT, you learn that like when students, like when kids who have developmental delays or cerebral palsy or whatever, if they can't do something, then they don't want to do it and they'll stop trying. And you know, it's just the same concept of like getting that just right challenge.
Yeah.
And it's like the same as teaching. Like even though they're like 18, 17, 27, everyone still wants to be able to achieve and learn, and you help facilitate that. To your practicals prepared and you have some knowledge, so you do feel like you can get the most out of that time. Secondly, don't...
Alright guys, welcome back to my channel. Thank you so much for joining me for this video. Today I have a special guest. This is Natea. She is a PhD candidate working on her PhD and is a pediatric OT. So you graduated last year?
Yeah, I did. I graduated in 2017, which is really exciting, from the University of Queensland here in Australia.
So I thought, because I know Natea has been an anatomy tutor for OT students and physio students for the last 4 years, this would be a great opportunity. So I know I've got a few first year students going through anatomy at the moment and being a bit stressed out, so So something I briefly touched on in, I made a previous video about advice for first year OT students. So something I touched on in that video was the importance and reasoning behind why OTs need to take anatomy courses and physiology courses. So is there some reasoning that you can let everyone else know?
So if you think about our degrees as occupational therapists, they fall under rehabilitation science, right? So being a science degree, what we want to make sure is that our degree, our knowledge, our foundational building blocks are based on what is empirically, factually true about the body. And those basic things outside of like doing genes and cells, which I think are, genes are probably too small for us, but we're looking at the body. So let's learn about the body in a really deep way. So then we can be able to ground what we say as an occupational therapist in the evidence, in what's really based in science.
I think something else is that I said in that video, it also gives us not only sometimes respect of other health professionals, because we can use it as a common language when working in more medical hospital settings. Even just being able to read medical charts can help communication between professionals.
And I think that in a space where we need to be both differentiating what we do as an OT compared to other health professionals, we also need to be establishing why our profession does have, is needed, but also why our scope of practice is grounded out of these other things. And so I think being able to recognize medical terms, being able to understand anatomy helps you with diseases and pathologies within like the clinical setting, but also allows you to talk about how the role of OT is more than just about those diseases and pathologies. So I think you can only differentiate those two with a good knowledge in both, and that's why they build it into our degree so early.
And I think it would surprise a lot of people, even just walking into the hospital setting for the first time, how many health professionals have no idea what OTs do, or they have a very specific idea because they had one example or one experience with like a hand therapist. Say, oh, that's just what you do, is it? So yeah, I think it's really important for us to be able to define and describe our scope of practice as you're talking about. Okay, so moving on to finding motivation to study and finding interest and enjoyment, because I know when you don't have interest and enjoyment, that motivation can be very difficult to obtain. You might need some more extrinsic motivations. So Natea, what's interesting or fascinating for you about anatomy?
So I have taught the same course, which is the basic anatomy course for OTs and physios, for 4 years. So I think every year an answer to that probably changes. But I think my greatest, to motivate myself to study and learn again, is because firstly, now being a clinician, you realize I actually do integrate that knowledge of anatomy and physiology into my day-to-day life. Yeah. Whether that's like, oh no, this child has problems writing, could that be? Is that it? It is like what's actually happening there? Is it some of the things we learn in OT around like positioning and things like that? But why is a position so important? And that's because of these muscles and joints and things like that. So they're actually all related. So I think clinically it makes me more motivated to know about anatomy. But also I think that it's a really social thing. Like, I remember when I was in first year and I didn't really know anyone in my course, but then you're thrown into the deep end with this subject with so much content, and you gather around this table for 4 hours a week with the same six or seven yeah. people, and they became my best friends within my course. And the time you spend outside of anatomy, like palpating each other and like looking at weird photos of yeah. bodies, I think it makes you grow closer to other people. Yeah. And it's through that you really feel like, yeah, like let's study, or like let's hang out and get coffee and do a bit of anatomy.
Yeah.
And either way, I think it's fun.
Okay, so my next question is, since you've gone through and seen so many cohorts over the years, what mistakes have you seen students make when studying anatomy?
So in studying anatomy, I think one of the first mistakes is that a lot of our students, they come straight from high school, and a lot of people tell them that university is going to be a little more relaxing, maybe less time in their schedule. Yeah. And then they get hit with this subject called anatomy, which seems like straightforward. Like, I know that I have a humerus, I know that I have a femur, and they think that they know bits about the body, but they don't understand the huge amount of content that yeah. we cover in such a short period of time. And you see students, the classic example is they get to week 3 and I walk into prac to teach them, and their eyes just glaze over, and it's like you see like the deer in the headlights yeah. of like, I haven't studied I don't know any of this, and I feel really overwhelmed and really scared, and I don't want to be here anymore. And so they leave.
Yeah.
And then they start missing class, and they start thinking they can't go to lectures because they didn't see the lecture before it, and it sort of becomes this vicious cycle. Yeah. And so when that happens, I think my best encouragement is just to slow it down with those students, to understand that they can ask questions about Prac 1 in Prac 5 if they need that extra support, and that with hard work, time dedicated, you can catch up and you can have a really solid knowledge no matter how overwhelmed you're yeah. feeling or how far behind you might have fallen.
And I think the sooner you can realize that you're feeling this way and identify that you're feeling overwhelmed is going to help you so much more, instead of leaving it until exam block, like the study period, then to realize, oh, I was feeling overwhelmed this whole time. That's what anatomy tutors are there for. They're there to answer your questions. They don't just come in each prac only knowing a few answers for that prac. They have a wealth of knowledge, and if they don't know something, they'll find someone who does.
And you're not, if you're feeling like that, you're not the only student that does. And I've seen so many students come through and feel the exact same way. Last year, I tutored a group of students privately who, a few of them failed like their overalls, and they had to do a supplementary exam. And then in that second semester, they really took the initiative to seek out a private tutor and gain that extra support. And I think if you change your actions, and all of those students passed, and so if you change what you do when you identify that you need more help, then it's really possible for any student to do really well.
Isn't it insanity doing the same thing over and over again expecting a different result?
Something like that.
Yeah, something needs to change. Okay, so we've talked about some of the mistakes students can make, but how about some more effective strategies you've seen students use?
So firstly, prepare. So make sure you're coming to your practicals prepared and you have some knowledge, so you do feel like you can get the most out of that time. Secondly, don't feel afraid to like get in there and get a specimen out and to look at the real examples of real muscles and real joints and real ligaments, because that's your really good opportunity to be able to do that. And if you don't have like a gross anatomy facility at your university, be looking at pictures of real bodies rather than just looking at your textbook and the diagrams. and then also have fun with it. So what I used to do is you have like mnemonics for your cranial nerves. They can be a bit funny, a bit racy, a bit like an inside joke for you and your friends, because we don't mind and we'd encourage that. I've seen people do the spinal nerves dance in exams. You see like their heads twitching and their like arms moving, and you know that that's what they're doing in your head. And there are also apps. There's this new app. I don't know what it's called. Complete Anatomy. I think it's called Complete Anatomy. Have you heard of it?
No.
Okay. There's this new app. It's called Complete Anatomy, I think. And what you can do is you can look at the different layers. So you can take layers off. Yeah. So you can isolate muscles. You can look at different layers. And it makes it really, really clear, which is something that's really good. And lastly, I used to do flashcards. And I used to draw pictures and color them in. Just remember that the aesthetics of those things don't matter, and you shouldn't be spending time on making it look pretty. And because sometimes I see people with really elaborate notes and they've just spent 3 hours coloring in their biceps femoris when they really should have just been learning the attachments for that muscle. So I think there's a balance between the two, but have fun with it. You know, I used to chuck up some anatomy notes on my shower wall and like have a shower, learn some origins and insertions. And just make sure you're chatting about it with your friends, like quick pop quizzes, or like have a quick reminder on your phone to test you on like your biceps brachii, like origins and insertions and things like that. So have fun with it.
Definitely. I've definitely had that mistake with the flashcards. I just left it too late, and then I had stacks of cards and it wasn't active learning when I was creating them.
Yeah, because some people, like, they spend, it takes 3 hours to make your flashcards, but you're only two days before an exam.
And it takes so long.
By the time you make them all, you're like, oh, I can't remember which one, what the attachments are for your triceps muscles. And then you're like, where's the triceps card? And you spend 5 minutes trying to find the triceps cards. And you realize you could have just been having it on a table or something.
Or there's online flashcard things like Quizlet. I've seen a lot of people get good use out of those as well.
Yeah, so make sure you look at all your options before you think like gung-ho on one and spend lots of time.
And it's your first year, so consider, you know, trying maybe a few different options out.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, definitely just give everything a go. Like, think, what type of learner am I? Am I visual? Am I written? Am I kinesthetic? Am I auditory? Like, I think at one point I recorded like a voice recording of me explaining something and chucked it on my car for a road trip. You know, be excessive. The world is big and there are lots of different opportunities to do things.
Absolutely. Okay, so my final question is, with our anatomy exams, I know at our university we had two. So we had a theory exam, which was multiple choice and short answer, and then we had a practical exam, which we would sometimes call a spotter exam. Could you just give us a quick idea of what that might look like?
So the theory exam has a multiple choice and a short answer component. So with that one, often the multi-choice is actually really, really challenging, because in anatomy there are lots of fine details that you have to know, so it's really easy for them to make really difficult alternate options that seem realistic. So just watch out with that. And the short answer is often on like a concept. They often do like compare the upper limb functions to the lower limb functions. That's really popular. And then in terms of your practical exam, what it was for at our university is there are stations set up with different specimens around the topics that you've learnt about across the semester. And there'll be two specimens per table. And you just start on one station, and you have 60 seconds, and there's a timer that goes off to write down the answers to two questions, and you're not allowed to touch the specimens or talk or look at the person next to you. You need to be focused on your one station, and then when that timer goes off, you'll be forced to move along to the next station. There'll be a few times where there's rest stations, and at these points that you have a minute, this is the 60 seconds, to be able to go through your answers, check them, change anything you need. And students often get confused at those stations. They don't use them to their best ability. They just think, maybe I'll have a look at the next one in front of me, or maybe I'll... So, like, you see it a lot. And one of my best pieces of advice is make sure you're underlining or circling or highlighting what the question is actually asking for. Is it asking for an attachment? Is it asking for a function? Is it asking for a tissue? Is it asking for the name of something, or just to identify something? Because there are lots of questions we can ask you about one single pin or one single, like, bone, tissue, anything. So make sure you're really clear about knowing that. And lastly, just take some deep breaths. 60 seconds is actually quite a lot of time to think about and think through things, rather than needing to just write down your first answer. And just know that even if there's one that you get a bit overwhelmed with and you're not sure, take the next question as a whole new question, because none of them are related, pretty much. So don't get overwhelmed if you can't do one. Just take a deep breath, move to the next one, start your thinking process again. And lastly, I'm not sure if some people like to talk about their exams or not talk about their exams afterwards, but often in anatomy, it's easier if you don't talk about them, just because often there's lots of speculation about what could have been, and it could have been close to this, and there may be lots of close options that the answer could have been, so that can cause more worry than anything.
No, I agree with that. Yeah. I'm not someone who talks usually about exams.
Yeah, and it's hard for advocate. No, that was right, because it was pinned there, because it's sort of like your opinion versus your friend's opinion. Yeah. So better to wait.
Well, thank you, Natea, so much for taking part in this interview.
Yeah, no
today.
Problem.
Really so appreciate good. It. So guys, don't forget to like, subscribe, and share this video with anyone who's taking anatomy. Share the advice. I'll see you guys next time.
Bye. See ya!